This is Kurt Heisinger, accounting professor at Sierra College and author of Managerial Accounting. This video describes how standard costs are used to record transactions. And this is really in a manufacturing environment primarily. We have many other videos that relate to using how to establish, first of all, standard costs, and then to using standard costs in a variety of ways, to establish budgets, to go and look at variances after the period is over to see how the company performed. Those standard costs can be used in many different ways, but here we're talking about the nuts and bolts of how to record transactions using standard costs. So many organizations do use a standard costing system to record transactions, and essentially a standard costing system requires that inventory and cost of goods sold transactions be recorded using standard costs. So all product costs go through these accounts, direct materials, direct labor, and manufacturing overhead are the product costs. All product costs go through these accounts, and they go through these accounts at the standard cost. In a standard costing system, therefore, all inventory accounts reflect at any point in time the standard cost information. So that brings up the question, what happens to variances between the standard cost and actual cost throughout the period? Well, the difference between the two, between the standard information, the standard cost, and the actual cost, is recorded in the variance accounts and also the manufacturing overhead account. And then at the end, we'll talk about this later on, in the end, these accounts are closed out to cost of goods sold. So we will get into those transactions a few slides down the line here. There are two primary benefits of using a standard costing system. First of all, companies that use a standard costing system, they're able to identify variances fairly quickly. So at the beginning of the period, we've established, let's say, a standard cost for direct materials. And if we make a purchase and that cost is higher than the standard, then we've identified that as soon as we make the purchase. And that's helpful. We can take action if needed, maybe to negotiate better prices with our vendors or to understand that our standard costs just aren't correct and make some adjustments accordingly. And then secondly, companies do use standard costs to value inventory and cost of goods sold. And that does simplify bookkeeping if we use standard costs as we go rather than having to use actual costs which fluctuate over the period that we're accounting for. So this slide and the following slides get into the debits and credits of recording transactions using a standard costing system. And these transactions all relate to product costs in a manufacturing setting. The first slide here shows an example of materials, price variance journal entry. So the entry here relates to the purchase of direct materials. And whenever we buy direct materials as a manufacturing company, we're going to have a price variance. It's very rare for that purchase to be exactly the same as the standard that we've established. So here we're looking at a situation where we have purchased raw materials. We purchased 440,000 pounds, and you can see what the actual price is. It's the accounts payable amount because that's what we actually owe the vendor. So we paid $1.20 per pound for these materials. We bought 440,000 pounds, and therefore we owe the vendor $528,000, and that's our credit to accounts payable. However, the standard that we had established for direct materials was $1 per pound, and I have several separate lectures that talk about how to establish standards and where that comes from. So here we're just assuming that the standard was $1 per pound and that we are actually paying $1.20 per pound. And therefore, we're going to debit raw materials inventory. Remember, the inventory accounts are always going to be at the standard amount, the standard cost. So we're going to debit raw materials inventory for that standard amount of $440,000. We then take the difference between the standard of $440,000 and the actual of $528,000, that difference of $88,000, and that goes to the materials price variance account. And it happens to be unfavorable in this example, so it's a debit to the materials price variance. Remember, these variances end up in cost of goods sold. So if we have a debit here, then ultimately that's going to be a debit to cost of goods sold or an increase to the expense account. So it's an unfavorable variance. That means that it increases the expense. And so this is how we record the purchase of direct materials at a $1 standard price per pound and an actual price of $1.20 per pound. This slide shows an example of recording the use of direct materials, that is pulling those direct materials out of the direct materials inventory or the storeroom and putting them into production. And this equates to a quantity variance, because what we're looking at here is what we expected to use according to our standards and what we actually used. Remember that the inventory accounts are always going to be based on the standard. So the debit to work in process that you see here of $420,000 is what we expected to use given actual production, and our standard price is $1 per pound. So it's $420,000. Well, it turns out we actually used 399,000 pounds, which is good news. We expected to use 420,000 pounds, and we actually used 399,000 pounds. So we multiply that times our standard price per pound, and that gives us the credit to raw materials inventory. And what comes out of this, what falls out of this, is a favorable materials quantity variance of $21,000. And it's a credit because it's favorable. And again, all of our variances get closed to cost of goods sold. So this will ultimately be a credit. It'll come out of here and go into cost of goods sold as a credit for $21,000, which reduces the expense, the cost of goods sold account. This entry shows what happens when we are recording the cost of direct labor and the resulting rate and efficiency variances. So what you see here is I'll start with the credit to wages payable. You see a credit to wages payable, and that includes the actual hours that our employees worked and the actual rate that we are paying them. So the amount that is credited to that account is $283,500. So remember, these are actual amounts, 18,900 hours, and $15 per hour is the rate. We're going to then see what we expected the hours to be, and this is our debit to work in process. It's at standard, both for the number of hours we expected and the rate that we expected. So you'll see here that we expected 21,000 hours from our direct labor workforce, so that's good news, because they worked 18,900 hours. So that's good news. We have a favorable then labor efficiency variance, and that's what you see right here. It's a credit, meaning it reduces the expense. It ultimately will be a credit to cost of goods sold. And then going over to the rate per hour, we actually paid $15 per hour, but we expected to pay $13 per hour. So that's an unfavorable variance. We paid more than we expected, and therefore we have a labor rate variance that is unfavorable, and that turns out to be unfavorable by $37,800. So again, we see the standard amount going into the inventory account, both in hours and per the rate per hour. We see the labor rate variance that is unfavorable as a debit to that account, because that ultimately will be transferred over to cost of goods sold as a debit to cost of goods sold, meaning it increases the expense account. And we see a favorable labor efficiency variance, and that's a credit because, again, that's going to be ultimately a credit to cost of goods sold when it gets transferred over there, and it reduces the expense account, the cost of goods sold account. So you've seen the entries that are related to direct materials and direct labor using a standard costing system. Now let's take a look at an example of manufacturing overhead and the journal entries that are associated with manufacturing overhead. In the first bullet point that you see here, we're looking simply at the actual overhead expenditures. So the assumption is that we spent $100,000 on variable manufacturing overhead and $136,000 on fixed manufacturing overhead, and therefore we spent a total of $236,000 on actual manufacturing overhead costs. So we're going to debit the manufacturing overhead account, right, where these are actual costs here. We're going to debit the manufacturing overhead account, and then we'll credit various accounts, and many of those typically are payable accounts, liability accounts. Then in the second entry, we're going to look at how to record when overhead is applied to products. And the idea here is that the application of overhead to products is based on standard cost information, and so we're going to debit work in process inventory when we apply those costs, and we have both variable and fixed costs in here, and then credit manufacturing overhead. So you'll see here that we credit overhead when we apply costs to products, and we debit manufacturing overhead when we record actual overhead costs. And you'll also notice here that we have then, at the end of the period, a $16,000 credit balance as a result of these two entries. That $16,000 credit balance then gets closed out in the next entry, so I'll show you how to do that next. Okay, there's a lot of information here, but if you look back at the last several slides, you'll notice that these variances all come from the previous slides that we looked at. So you can scroll back to those slides and take a look, and you'll see these numbers pop out of those slides. So what we're trying to show here is that we need to close out the variance accounts. And all of those variance accounts that we identified in the previous slides get closed out to cost of goods sold. So this is an example of closing manufacturing overhead and our variance accounts all over to cost of goods sold. There's more information here. It has to do with Jerry's ice cream. This is an example that I've been using quite a bit for talking about establishing budgets and then doing variance analysis. So that's where that comes from. And all the numbers relate together. So if you go look at any of those other slides and any other videos that relate to Jerry's ice cream, they all use consistent numbers across the board. What we have here, though, at the bottom, and I want to just simply focus on this entry right here, is the closing out of all of our variance accounts and of the manufacturing overhead account. And it all ends up right here in cost of goods sold. So that $61,500 debit to cost of goods sold is simply a net of all of these other entries that you see here. And that's what's required to make this whole thing balance out. So we're closing out, let me just go through a couple of these. We're closing out then the materials quantity variance. It had a credit balance of $21,000, so now we need to debit it, $21,000, and then it goes away. We had a credit balance in the labor efficiency variance. If you go back a few slides, you'll see that. And now we need to close that out, so we're going to debit it, $27,300. The same thing with manufacturing overhead on the previous slide. We had a credit balance of $16,000, and we now need to close that, so we're going to debit it, $16,000. And then finally, We had a debit balance in the materials price variance, so we're going to credit that for that to go away. And we had a debit balance in the labor rate variance, and we need to credit that for that to go away. And all of this then, netted out, goes to cost of goods sold. So the balances that were in all of these accounts netted to a debit of $61,500, and we're simply moving that over to cost of goods sold, and that is exactly what you see right here. And what that means is we have to increase cost of goods sold. It's an expense account. We're debiting it, so we're increasing it by $61,500.